Hello everyone, and welcome to my build video for the SCALEBREAKER patch. Now, SCALEBREAKER patch is one of the biggest patches I've ever seen in this game happening, and it's weird because the patch is actually filled with great changes like the nerfs to SMB, nerfs to heavy armor, nerfs to pirate skeleton, buffs to mobility and medium armor, which all are indirect buffs to Stamblade and make the 2H4 archetype probably the best thing you can play on a Stamblade this patch. And with such a big patch and a bit of a meta shift that is coming in SCALEBREAKER patch, there are big changes to my build as well, which is not what you're gonna see very often. So let's just jump right into it. So first of all, what I'm gonna run for the next patch is Truth, Bloodspawn and Spriggan. Pretty simple. Why Truth instead of Shacklebreaker? Because I'm running two Fighters Guild skills on my front bar and I want to take advantage of the huge weapon damage multipliers I'm gonna have next patch. Truth is outperforming Shacklebreaker and any other sustain set in terms of the damage output, which sounds a bit stupid, but when I make my builds, it's either I get my sustain from a sustain set or I get my sustain from jewelry. Now, Truth has so much built-in damage that you amplify with all the weapon damage multipliers that I can get my sustain from jewelry pieces, for example, infused stem recovery or infused magicka reduced cost, and I will still end up having more damage than getting my sustain from sustain sets like Shacklebreaker, for example. And that's why I wear Truth next patch. It's really easy to proc, gets you a lot of weapon damage, and the damage is completely insane. I've been dueling with it, not a lot, a little bit, on PTS, and I fell in love with this build. What I also forgot to mention is that I run a Nirnhold Maul with double dot poisons on my front bar. Last patch, I ran a Sharpened Maul with double dot poisons on my front bar, and that's because Sharpened last patch was more damage. This patch, the two Fighters Guild skill lines that you have equipped on your front bar close the damage gap between Sharpened and Nirnhold. So there is no reason in running Sharpened front bar next patch on a Maul, because Nirnhold gives you the exact same damage. I tested it out against a 30k resist build and a 16k resist build, and the damage difference between those two traits are 2 to 3 damage points, and that's basically nothing. Here you can see also my CP, everything adjusted to the next patch, no more points into the file, you don't need it. Still 1 point into Siphoner, 81 into Tumbling, great. What you're gonna notice in my build is that I run Lava Food Soup and Salt Rice, and I run 25 points into health. Why that? Because food like Artium and Dubious have been nerfed very heavily previous patch already, and I've been running Lava Food Soup in elsewhere as well before. Now, I've been trying going Tristat by foods as well, but they are not stat dense enough, and I simply cheated myself through getting the old Dubious or the old Artium in form of getting Lava Food Soup, applying it to myself, and then putting points into health, and I get a lot of stat density like that. I have 25k health in PvP, and with Dubious or Artium, you're gonna have around 25.4-25.2k HP in PvP as well, so the health loss isn't big, it's like 200 to 400 health loss, and you gain a lot of damage by running Lava Food Soup simply because it gives you so much sustain and it gives you so much max stamina, it's crazy. So that's like my little trick that they've done for the past few months, and everybody has been asking me how I get so much health with it and if it's even like good to put points into the health attribute, but yeah, it's pretty good. Now, coming to my skills and what I'm gonna run on my skill bars next patch. So my bars are gonna look like this. Relentless Focus, Surprise Attack, Rally, Turn Evil, Camouflage Hunter, and Incap on my front bar. Rally gives you no more the health over time effect, but instead it gives you minor endurance, and that's something that's crazy strong on the Nightblade, especially when you play a region build like mine. I was running Ambush on my front bar previous patch in almost all of my videos, and I didn't enjoy the skill. The skill gets you a lot of damage because minor vulnerability is so overtuned, but at the same time this skill is clunky, filled with bugs where you just cannot move sometimes, and it's absolutely terrible to play with. I hated every single second I played with it, and I'm happy to say that there is a great alternative to Ambush next patch, and that is Camouflage Hunter. It gives you minor berserk, which is really easy to proc when you're Nightblade. Flanking is really easy in the game. You don't even have to be behind an enemy to flank somebody. You have to be like only 45 degrees in the angle of your enemy, and you're already gonna flank them. It gives you major savagery, which is 10% more crit chance, and it gives you 3% more weapon damage, which is about 50 to 60 weapon damage realistically. And it also gives you minor berserk, which is just sweet. It's half the damage of minor vulnerability, but considering that you get 10% weapon crit, 3% weapon damage, and you get minor berserk, it's a very good alternative to Ambush, and you don't even have to activate it. It's just there on your bar. And you don't even have to use attack pots anymore, because, well, Camouflage Hunter, if you activate it, it reveals all enemies in a radius of you. So it's a great open world skill as well when you fight those annoying Nightblades. And I never really have any issues with fighting Nightblades when I use my attack pots, so this is gonna make my life a lot easier as well. Now, I switched my Hysteria for Turn Evil. My Hysteria and Turn Evil are almost the same skills, besides that Turn Evil has one con to it, and that is it has a small delay in the animation when you try casting it. When you see, it has a small delay tied to the animation where you throw that thing on the ground, and it needs a little bit time before it actually pops and fuses your enemy. Also, this skill gets casted in exactly the spot where you clicked it, unlike Hysteria that moves with your character. For example, when I run around, place my skill, you see that it didn't land where I originally, where the animation originally ended. No, it landed behind me where I originally casted it. That means that when you're playing lag, or when you're tracing somebody, you're most likely not gonna fear the enemy, and you have to be very precise and have to be sure that you can fear somebody, or that somebody isn't gonna move away from the circle, or else you're gonna waste your stamina. But why am I using this skill? It's simple. I don't have to use Temple or Guard on my back bar anymore, because this skill gives me minor protection when I'm inside of it, and you can quite easily cheat yourself way into, like, just like, you know, staying in the circle when you're trying to play defensive, or kiting around a rock and placing the circle just so you get that extra mitigation. It's a great skill. It also costs stamina, which is a huge pro to stand this, because we struggle with magicka sustain. We need that magicka sustain already for Shadow Image and Cloak, so having to have even more magicka sustain just to cast your stun was really annoying, especially in next patch where Shadow Image costs more. Hysteria is so much more annoying to waste your magicka on, and this is a great alternative just because it costs stamina. It's lovely. And it also doesn't have a cap on how many enemies you can fear, like Hysteria does on 6 people. You can fear, I think, up to 12 people with that one skill, because the original AoE cap in the game is 12 people. So when you're trying to escape from a large group of people, you just throw it down and run away, and they're gonna be all feared and annoyed. Renter's Focus will always stay on my bar. This skill is even better this patch because it lost its delay, where you can just ball proc into incap and it will hit at the same time. Almost at the same time. So it's a great combo skill, and it doesn't have that annoying delay it had before. Now my back bar didn't change or not. I'm still having Shadow Image, the best defensive skill there is in the game. And it has been fixed, so you can actually fight with this skill on towers and castles again. Which was crazy to me when I saw that. I thought I would not see that bug fix for the next 3 years, probably. So, ZeniMax surprised me with that one. It's a great patch. Poison Injection. That skill, a lot of people say it has been nerfed because it lost its execute multiplier, but that's not true because the extra damage we got on the damage over time effect itself outperforms the execute multiplier we had. Simple as. The damage over time effect, I think it received like 70% damage increase, and we lost 160 damage multiplier. And Resolving Vigor, Cloak, Shuffle, and Temporal Guard. You don't have to you don't have to use Temporal Guard. I would say it's better if you use Soul Siphon on your back bar, especially when you duel with somebody or a trio. This is a great defensive skill, and because you have Turn Evil on your front bar already, which gives you mana protection, you don't really have to have Temporal Guard at all times. You can either have Soul Siphon, or the Werewolf skill on your back bar for even more sustain. This is probably gonna make you over sustain, so I'd rather run Soul Siphon. Great skill. So just to show you what this build can do. Right off the bat, even when I buff myself up with only Rally, with only Major Brutality, and my Nundurids, you can see, whoops, I didn't have my hood on. You can see that I have 4k weapon damage, 2.6k stem recovery, just with Major Brutality, and that's not on a full weapon damage build, not even my Truth was procced. This is on a build that utilizes Priggen, and that's just simply a lot of damage. Just with my Major Brutality, I have a tooltip of 10.2k surprise attack and 16k in cap. Now, when we see, when we look at the stats that are buffed with Major Brutality, Truth, and the weapon damage enchant from my back bar, you're gonna see that we have 5.3k weapon damage. And when you buff ourselves with the potion, we have 3k stem recovery. So this build is absolutely crazy. When we look at the fully buffed stats, that's with Truth, weapon damage enchant, continuous attacks, and Master's Bow, which doesn't show on your tooltip, but you can see it on USB build editor. You have 6.1k weapon damage. That's absurd for a Stamblade. You're gonna have so much damage next patch, it's insane. Also, when you activate off-balance, let's say you have off-balance on your enemy, and you look at your tooltips of surprise attack and incap, just look at this. Look at those tooltips. Those are the fattest tooltips I played with for the longest time, and I'm so happy to be about to play with them, because those tooltips were only really like accessible with crazy builds like Clever Alchemist, which didn't have a constant uptime. And we talk about Truth here, which has 100% uptime in open world. Hell, I have a 90% uptime of Truth even in a duel. And it's so much just flat out burst damage, it makes people hate you so much because you just come out of cloak, combo somebody perfectly, and their health bar is gone. And this is what Stamblade is supposed to be about. Just pure out full fist burst damage that makes people hate you. Now, as I explained previously, our max sustain got a lot better next patch because you don't have to waste your Magicka on your main style, which is Messy Sera. Therefore, I decided to not run as much max sustain next patch anymore, and I felt that I have just enough max sustain in a duel without any Magicka recovery built in nor max Magicka built in. The only thing I run that would be considered as max sustain are my Trigliers, which basically give me maximum Magicka. Now, if you don't feel comfortable with the max sustain on this build, which I still have to test in open world and see if I even feel comfortable with the max sustain in open world, then you can run a jewelry piece with reduced Magicka cost of spells. Reduced Magicka cost is better than Magicka recovery on builds that have no Magicka regen multipliers. Therefore I went with that. And even when you have a infused Magicka cost reduce and an infused stamina recovery glyphs on your jewelry, you still do more damage than a SCALEBREAKER build. That's what I tested and that's true, you still have more damage stats. And this is a bit overkill. An infused reduced Magicka cost glyph on your jewelry is overkill. You're gonna have so much maxes that you're not gonna know what to do with it. So I'd rather not go infused on your max sustain ring, I'd rather go robust, so it can pull out more damage. It's not much, but it's some. So yeah, that's it for me. Enjoy the build, enjoy the next patch, the next patch is gonna be great, and here I have a few clips of what this build can do to a person on PTS. Enjoy!